I was studying with Michael Evsharian, who is a local violin instructor and owner of Shire Music, and Louis's daughter was also studying with Michael at the same time. And what I remember about Louis was I assumed he was actually not a very good pianist because he was so nice. And so when my dad said, you know, he teaches at the University of Michigan, I was like, what? Like, you mean Mr. Nagel? You know, so he's so kind, and it's not just to adults. He's kind to children too, and he always treated me like I had a lot to say, which obviously I do. So that's what I mean, and then his playing is of course sublime, and it's just nice to know someone who's able to do both, be a good person and play music beautifully. So thank you for listening to my spiel, and I hope you will enjoy Louis Nagel.
Dave, I've never had an introduction like that before. I'm almost at a loss for words. I was going to talk a little bit about the Italian concerto. So let me regroup for a second. I've played this piece a number of times, and more than once I have had either a young person or an adult come up to me and say, well, where's the orchestra? Now, for those of you who know this piece, that's a kind of a humorous question, but I'm going to assume that you might not know exactly what's going on here. When Bach wrote for the keyboard, encompassing the years roughly 1714 to the years of his late years, he died in 1750, he was writing largely for a harpsichord or possibly a clavichord. He did not write for the piano. The piano had been invented. He didn't really know about it with any degree of information until the late 1740s. What he had on the harpsichord for much of his life was a one-manual harpsichord that played pretty much the same color all the way through. There are things you can do to it, but it was pretty much the same color. Therefore, the concept of dynamics was not really a critical issue in his keyboard output. However, he did write a series of pieces, the Klavierübung, four volumes of compositions for a two-manual harpsichord. And that meant that there were two keyboards, and you could get a greater variety of color. And in those pieces, he would occasionally write piano and forte. Mm-hmm. And that didn't mean loud and soft necessarily, it meant this keyboard or that keyboard, which had a different color, one brighter than the other. When he wrote these pieces, the partitas in the first volume, the Italian concerto and the French overture in the second volume, some organ pieces and four duets in the third volume, and only one piece in the fourth volume, but it's an enormous piece, the Goldberg Variations. He was writing for an instrument that could replicate something of orchestral sound. So he writes a piece called the Concerto in the Italian Style, modeled after works by Vivaldi and Corelli, and taking advantage of the fact that you could play different colors on a two-manual harpsichord. This is what's going on in the Italian concerto, and it sounds a little bit like an orchestra. Not a full orchestra, of course, but a little bit. So the title, Concerto in the Italian Style, Italian Concerto. Three movements, fast, slow, fast, and I don't know what's in your program, but the first movement should be allegro in brackets because we don't actually have in his handwriting the word allegro on a manuscript. Is it done that way? All right, allegro, slow, and fast. So, the Italian concerto of J.S. Bach. little thing about this piece that really means a lot to me. I thought I'd save it for afterwards. 1957. It's before a few of you in this room were born. And I know who you are. I had a lesson. My teacher at the time, Grant Graves, who was a teacher at the University of Louisville Prep Department, arranged for me to have a lesson with a harpsichordist, a German, I think, emigre harpsichordist who was based on the West Coast, and she was doing a tour of the country, and she came to Louisville to do a program. Her name was Alice Ehlers. Possibly some of you know that name. She was very prominent at the time, and he arranged for me to play this for her. And this was an eye and ear opening experience for me. I'd never played for somebody who was supposedly world famous. At least I didn't think I had. And she took one look at the Von Bülow edition that I was using. Those of you who are musicians know exactly where I'm going with this. And her eyes rolled heavenward and she wasn't praying. She was the first person ever to explain to me and to introduce me to the concept of the Urtext, the original score. Not the manuscript copy, although that I have some of those in my collection too. But what Bach wrote, not what Hans von Bülow thought should happen in 1880 when he edited that piece, which was good for 1880. But the level of scholarship then is not the level of scholarship that we have now. She is the person who opened my eyes and ears to the Urtext. And I am forever grateful to both Mr. Graves, my teacher then, and for Madam Ehlers, who showed me, put me on a path of a little bit more scholarly pursuit than the Von Bülow edition would invite. So I thought I would mention that. I have no idea whether Alice Ehlers, I had no idea, I never followed up with her, but I am very grateful to her. Now, the next piece on the program happens to be the very, very first time I played here in a concert, possibly also before a few of you in this room were born. A little shaky on that one. The Tempest Sonata. And the title has nothing to do with Shakespeare's play, although supposedly when somebody, probably Schindler, asked Beethoven, but Maestro, what does this music mean? He gave two answers. These both appeared in books about this situation. The first one, what does this mean? He sat down and played it again. Which is the best. I'm not going to do that much. It's hard enough to play it once. But the second one was, he said, to read The Tempest. And there's a third statement about the last movement having to do with horses galloping across the cobblestones outside his apartment. But I'm not. That last movement doesn't have anything to do with horses. It actually has something more to do with the Energizer Bunny. Because it starts and it just doesn't stop. But this piece, what I'd like to do is to give you a little tiny bit of background. This piece comes from 1802. This is the same time that the Heiligenstadt Testament appeared. It didn't appear in print. It actually stayed in his desk for a long time. It was addressed to a blank and my brother, Johann, and it never got sent. But it has been was discovered to be, to start out as a suicide note. Mm-hmm. And then in the middle of it, it becomes a kind of an et resurrexit. I'm going to conquer fate, I'm going to seize fate by the throat. And the reason for this, of course, is that he is now admitting to the world that he's going deaf. Mm-hmm. Now, Beethoven had this habit of writing in threes, groups of threes. So Opus 31, number 2, is the middle sonata amid two others. And I'd just like to play the beginnings of those sonatas because you will hear how very, very different and how important contrast was to this composer. Opus 31, number 1, I often call the drunk sonata. just because the hands are not together. The second movement is long and just full of ornamentation. It sounds like bad Mozart. And the last movement is a fiendishly difficult but also gorgeously beautiful rondo. 31 number 3 is curious because it really doesn't have a slow movement and it doesn't really start in the key. Tarantella, two of the happiest sonatas that he writes, and in between is this tempestuous piece, the Tempest Sonata. So even though he didn't call it the Tempest, you will hear even little anticipations of the Ninth Symphony, also in D minor, and you will hear Beethoven at his most dramatic, his most intense, his most serious, and considerably difficult for the pianist. It's one of the several of the great Titanic sonatas among the 32. So the Tempest Sonata, Opus 31, number 2. Thank you. bolted out of the hallway here and almost knocked someone down in the process. So the next pieces, I do know what I'm going to play. But the first, at least I think I do. But the first time I played this program about 2 months ago, I was not sure. And I had a couple of other pieces in mind. And I said, I don't want to commit until I'm actually on the stage. And it's stayed that way because it's kind of fun to talk about these pieces too. In his early career, Brahms wrote for the piano. He was a pianist, and apparently he was a phenomenal pianist of Liszt-ian accomplishment, but certainly not Liszt-ian style technique. And he wrote three magnificent sonatas, the F minor, the last one, Opus 5, the third sonata, in particular is one of the monuments of our piano repertoire. And then he wrote sets of variations. The two greatest sets would be the Brahms Handel variations and the infamously difficult Brahms Paganini variations, but he wrote other sets as well. And for the most part after that, he didn't write much for the piano solo. And at the end of, or towards the end of the middle part and at the end of his life, he came back. So these pieces actually span from around 1878 until his death in 1897. They span the last probably quarter to a third of his life. And he wrote short character pieces. Opus 76 has eight pieces in it, from which I'll be playing numbers 1 and 5. I'm sorry, numbers 1 and 6. Opus 79 are the two rhapsodies. Opus 116 is a set of seven pieces from which I'll be playing the E major, the second E major, 116, number 6. And Opus 118, I'll be playing the ballade, the third one. And then I'll be playing the last two from Opus 119. So we're getting a kind of a picture of Brahms in his latter days, when the piano seems to have become a close friend rather than an obstacle to be conquered. That's not to say that the last piece on the program is one of the hardest pieces that I play. It's an obstacle to be conquered still. But the sounds that he gets and the beautiful colors that he gets from the piano are so remarkable. You could play any 6 or any 7 and have the same joy. These are intimate pieces, perfect for this environment. So, 6 short pieces with varied titles, Capriccio, Ballade, Intermezzo, Rhapsody, varied titles from the last period of Brahms. Thank you. variation too. Comical figure. I didn't say at the beginning, this is the first time I've done a series of these, a 3Bs program. That was a phrase that actually, I didn't know, was actually coined originally by a minor 19th century composer about Bach, Beethoven, and Berlioz. So I probably should be playing. The Symphonie Fantastique, but von Bülow, another B, coined the phrase Bach, Beethoven, and Brahms. And that's what has stuck, and it's certainly very appropriate. So since I began with Bach, why don't we bookend this and end with one of my favorite pieces of Bach.